What are motivating cyber attacks today?
Well, it's across a range of actors with different motivations. So, for example, there are nation states that are active, as well as criminal organizations that are active globally. You also have ideologically driven and politically driven groups and hacktivists, as well as what are called the lone wolf hackers. It could be financial motivation, it could be because of, again, their ideological bent, or certainly from the nation state perspective, their own national interests. So there are any number of range of actors, but the important thing to know is that individuals may be the victim of a cyber attack across those entire range of folks who are looking to either disrupt, to steal, or to destroy by using cyberspace.
Did the hacker activities change in anyhow or in funding? Are they looking for new kinds of funding today?
Well, first off, these hacker organizations in many cases are extremely well funded. In some cases, they have their own R&D organizations within themselves. They also have marketing professionals who are trying to sell the information that they steal. So whether it is these types of activities to take advantage of the information or data that they may steal, or the types of tools and methodologies they may use to extract that information, it's constantly changing. And that's a big challenge for governments and businesses trying to address cybersecurity today, because these actors often move faster than bureaucracies can move to solve the problems.
And how can organization deal with that? I mean, there are a lot of technology needs to be implemented in order that there is the profile, the people skills on that. So how to balance that?
The most important thing for any organization is to perform an assessment on itself. In other words, it's often very tough to look at cybersecurity because it's so broad. It touches everything an organization does, its most sensitive communications, the way it reaches third-party organizations and its partners. This is not like boiling the ocean. What you need to do is look at your own organization, assess where you have your own vulnerabilities, what are the most important assets you need to defend within your organization, and from there you can set a plan for how you're going to address those vulnerabilities and reduce the risk. But most importantly, there's this concept of resilience, which means how will my organization have the ability to bounce back after an attack?
Tell me more about the resilience. I mean, is it critical to build a strategy based on that? And how do organizations need to address that?
Well, I'm from the U.S., and if the White House and the Department of Defense sustain attacks that have been successful, then certainly any organization across the globe is going to be potentially vulnerable. So the idea of resilience says that it is likely that your organization will sustain attack or a data breach at some point. It's the nature of the environment, that if you have one pipe open, someone will figure a way to get into your organization. But are you prepared to respond to that with the right forensics teams to go in and find out where the problem is and to remediate that from a technical standpoint? But also, is your organization set to deal with the decisions that must be made, the human element of cybersecurity? That is, are the leaders, have they been drilled on how they will respond to an attack with individuals across their organization? Not to be surprised, and I think that's the key element with being a resilient organization. Not just having a plan, but having the ability to bounce back and continue your operations.
And also to act under a really stress.
Absolutely, and that's why having the leaders of an organization, not just the IT team, but the leadership of that organization at the highest level, actually consider these types of scenarios, conduct drills or exercises so that in the middle of an incident, it's not the first time they're thinking about the types of decisions they're going to have to make. And again, the decisions will not just be with the IT team. It's going to be with everyone who's potentially impacted by a cyber breach.
And how to balance privacy and security? I think they shouldn't be excluded, but it kind of sometimes it's really difficult to put them together and to find out a really best balanced way to build the security and to prevent attacks.
Well, this is one of the great struggles that we have in the 21st century. There's a great amount of pressure on governments to prevent attacks from happening. At the same time, particularly amongst the great democracies, we want to ensure that we're protecting privacy and civil liberties of our citizens. We're still having a difficult time with this challenge, but it shouldn't stop us from advancing as quickly as possible towards governance structures to ensure that within our particular countries, and certainly from a global nature, that we start to have those types of protocols so that we can have an expectation and that citizens can have an expectation of how their privacy and civil liberties will be protected. Now, this varies all over the globe, and that makes it difficult.
And how do you think these two things are going to evolve?
Well, it's going to take a dialogue, but a dialogue that's not focused just on what the problem is, but how we do resolve oftentimes political, not just technological barriers to maintaining both security and privacy. That has to take place on a global basis. The internet has no borders. And although we would like to, within our individual countries, micromanage how civil liberties and security are taken care of, it's just not possible in cyberspace. So it requires a great deal of collaboration and a lot more aggressive pursuit of protocols amongst countries to deal with these issues.
And should it get put together, enterprise, government, and people in general, and the society?
Absolutely. It is so critical that the public sector and the private sector and non-governmental organizations all be a part of this discussion. We are so interconnected. We are inextricably linked via cyberspace. So we must ensure that all of the stakeholders are at the table for these discussions, that they're not just viewed through the governmental lens or the private sector lens, but across the board. And always citizens must be at the heart of those discussions.